Welcome back, everybody, to this week's episode of the Taking a Breath podcast. I'm Parker, and joining me today for our episode is Bob Klima. He's the founder and the chairman of the board of directors for CDFI, stands for Children with Disabilities Fund International. It's a nonprofit based in Virginia that also operates in Kenya and Jamaica, and these two locations are doing incredible things for children with disabilities, both in the healthcare and the education fields. So check this episode out, talking all about lasting impact and specifically the impact that he and the CDFI organization are doing. Also, if you're interested in more information about them, check them out at thecdfi.org. Enjoy
the primary thing is that I am the father of a severely disabled child. My son, Ethan, who is my youngest child, was born in 1990. And his birth changed our lives totally. It completely upset everything. Prior to that time, I'd had no real experience with disabled children, and I didn't know what to do. It turned out to be, of course, an extremely difficult road to walk. Parents who care for severely disabled children know what I'm talking about, but if you haven't walked that path, you would never know. In the United States, we have lots of resources, and I'm very thankful for the resources which were made available to us as a family. But during the long, hard years of raising my son and my other three children, I became aware that in developing countries, a totally different situation existed. I heard people give reports about children who were treated abominably. I remember a thing I saw on the news about Romania, for example, where disabled children were tied down all day, left under horrible circumstances, abused in many ways. And then I heard from missionaries that they had found similar situations in other countries. I'm thinking particularly of Indonesia that had come to my mind at that time. And in 2009, I found myself in a situation where I had the opportunity to go on a mission trip with a church in my area. And I went to the organizational meeting. They were going to go to the country of Jamaica. And I knew that they spoke English. I'd been on a mission trip to Nicaragua and couldn't do much because I didn't speak the language.
Right.
Well, I went to this meeting, and the man who was describing what was going on was showing pictures of other trips they had taken to Jamaica. And he showed pictures of West Haven Children's Home, which is a home for severely disabled children in Jamaica. And he said, this was a very, very sad situation. We couldn't do anything, so we'll probably not go there again. So I raised my hand and said, that is where I want to go.
That's fantastic. I'm curious. So you mentioned, and I know that you guys operate now in both Jamaica and Kenya. Kenya, that location started in about 2017, if I'm remembering correctly.
A little earlier than that.
Okay. And so what then, you had visited Jamaica, had started to really plant yourselves there. When did that shift happen to then also being a part of the community in Kenya?
Okay. Well, the way that happened was this. When you start a nonprofit, of course, you're going to create a website. So we created a website. And the problem of children with disabilities in developing countries is one of the largest unmet needs in the world. Most people don't know about it because it really is a silent suffering. These children can't speak for themselves and they don't have advocates. So when the website went up, of course, people all around the world found the website because they were searching for help. I have received pleas from no less than 20 different countries of people who are trying to help disabled children in those countries, and all they need is some money wisely spent to help them to do what they're doing. Unfortunately, we are such a low-funded organization, we're so small, we're all volunteer, that I have to tell these people I don't have any money to help them.
Right.
But in the midst of all of that, I was contacted by a woman in Kenya who has an interesting story herself as to how she got called to do this. And I told her I couldn't help her because I didn't have any money, but she wouldn't let it go. She started coming back and say hello again, and she just kept making the plea over and over again. And so I wasn't going to send money to the other side of the world without knowing what was going on.
Right.
And we had had some contact with the well-known organization World Vision, which is a Christian worldwide relief organization. So one day I said, well, I wonder if World Vision has a presence in Kenya. So I went to my computer and I typed in World Vision Kenya, and up came a big website. It turns out they have a huge presence in Kenya.
Wow.
And they had the email address of the president of World Vision Kenya. So I thought, what the heck? I wrote him an email. And I said, you don't know me from Adam, but there's this organization. How'd you like to go check them out?
Yeah.
And he said, sure.
Wow.
And I got back a quarter inch thick professional evaluation of the charity. We didn't pay a penny for it. World Vision did it purely out of the goodness of their hearts.
Wow.
And it gave us the basis to believe that we could send some money there. And we began, but it was small at first. And then I knew I had to go there personally. And so in December of 2016, I and my son-in-law, Jeff, made the trip there to make the personal evaluation. And what we found was satisfactory. We formed very close relationships. World Vision has continued to provide third-party accountability. I believe very strongly in that principle.
When you reached out to World Vision, that was the response that came back, the evaluation, the support. I think for young people, because this is something that I hear a lot, there's such a hesitation to reach out to people because they feel like, or we feel like, I've been guilty of this as well, that, oh, well, I have nothing to offer in return, or I am not at a place where I can, you know, I'm not at the same level, or things like that. And I think that story is so encouraging to me, and I'm sure to listeners, because just that effort to reach out and share your story, what's happening, this opportunity now, they're this accountability partner, they're helping. So I think there's so much value. And even for just one individual, even if it's something as simple as learning from someone who you view as so far ahead of you or those types of things, I think there's so much value in just the simple act of reaching out.
That's true, Parker. And I want to add to that. Most Americans don't think a lot about the problem of poverty around the world. Frankly, we waste an extraordinary amount of money in the United States on frivolities, on fancy cars or houses or vacations or any number of other things. We don't realize how rich we are compared to the rest of the world. But the truth is, a very, very small amount of money by American standards is a huge amount of money in these other countries. Mm. And if it is spent wisely, a huge difference can actually be made. I believe that we have made a profound difference in the lives of 100 children in Jamaica and 200 children and their families in Kenya. Now, that's a drop in the bucket to world poverty. I get it. But it's important. And if everybody took on whatever they could do, we could make a bigger difference.
After the episode, thecdfi.org is their website. Please check it out. I wanted to put that so that I don't forget, because there's so much information about it and ways that you can get involved, including that sponsorship program for listeners. But so with this this business thing, the things that they're doing, Holly mentioned that there has been some struggle with COVID. Does that include some of these things that you're talking about that they have still been able to do, or is some of that, has some of that shifted since COVID started?
Well, I'm afraid it's really come to a halt.
I see.
Because the little things they were able to do, they could no longer do. You know, COVID is an inconvenience to Americans.
Right.
It's a life-threatening event to people in poor countries.
Yes.
And so we are just trying to maintain the status quo. We're going to have to try to get back to where they were before when this situation finally changes.
Thanks so much for joining us for this week's video highlights. We'll see you again next week for another episode of Taking a Breath.